Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Respected brothers, respected sisters, salamu alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you so much for joining us tonight for our English program on behalf of Idara Jafariya. Before we begin the majlis for tonight, we kindly request a brother Nihal Naqvi for the English translation of Hadith Al-Qisa. Brother Nihal, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet, peace be on them, is to have thus related an event. My father, the Prophet of Allah, came to my house one day and said to me, "Peace be on you, Fatima." I replied, "And upon you be peace." Then he said, "I feel weakness in my body." I said, "Allah protects you from weakness, father." He said, "Fatima, please bring the Yemeni cloak and cover me with it." So I brought the Yemeni cloak and covered him with it. Then I looked at him and saw that his face was shining like a full moon with its glory and splendor. After a while, my son Hassan came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you peace, O light of my eyes and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a fragrance so sweet and so pure as that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather is lying underneath the cloak." Hassan went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my son and master of my fountain, Gother. You are given the permission to enter." So Hassan entered the cloak with them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. After a while, my Hussein came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you peace, O light of my eyes and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather and your brother are lying underneath the cloak." Hussein stepped towards the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, the chosen of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my son and interceder of my followers. You were given the permission to enter." So Hussein entered the cloak with them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. After a while, Abul Hasan Ali ibn Abi Talib came in and said, "Peace be on you, O daughter of the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "And upon you peace, O father of Hassan and the commander of the faithful." He then said, "Fatima, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my brother, my cousin, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, he is underneath the cloak with your two sons." So Ali went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my brother, my legatee, my successor, and my standard bearer. You are given the permission to enter." So Ali entered the cloak with them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Then I stepped forward and said, "Peace be on you, my father, O Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you peace, my daughter, O part of myself. You are given the permission to enter." So I entered the cloak with them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Getting together underneath the cloak, my father, the Prophet of Allah, held the two ends of the cloak and raised his right hand towards the heavens and prayed, "O Allah, these are the people of my household, Ahlul Bayt. They are my confidants and my supporters. Their flesh is my flesh, and their blood is my blood. Whoever hurts them, hurts me too. Whoever displeases them, displeases me too. I am at war with those, at war with them. I am at peace with those, at peace with them. I am the enemy of their enemies, and I am the friend of their friends. They are from me and I am from them. O Allah, bestow your blessings, benevolence, forgiveness, and your pleasure upon me and upon them, and remove impurity and keep away impurity from them and keep them thoroughly pure." Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Then the Lord Almighty Allah said, "O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily I have not created the erected sky, stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships, but for the love of these five lying underneath the cloak." Gabriel, the trusted angel, asked, "Who are under the cloak?" The Almighty answered, "They are the household of the Prophet and the assets of prophethood. They are Fatima, her father, her husband, and her two sons. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad." Gabriel said, "O Lord, may I fly to earth to be the sixth of them?" Allah replied, "Yes, you are given the permission." Gabriel the trusted landed near them and said, "Peace be on you, O Prophet of Allah. The All-Highest conveys his peace on you and his greetings and says, By my honor and glory, O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily I have not created the reckless sky, the stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships, but for your sake and love. God has given me permission to enter the cloak with you. May I join you, O Prophet of Allah? Prophet replied, And peace be on you, O trusted bearer of Allah's revelations. You are granted the permission. So Gabriel entered the cloak with us and said to my father, Allah sends his revelations to you. Verily, Allah's desire is to remove blemish from me, to keep away blemish from you, O people of the household, and purify you with the perfect purification. Then Ali said to my father, O Prophet of Allah, tell me what significance has Allah given for getting together underneath his cloak? The Prophet replied, By him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of the mankind, whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mentions this event, Allah will bestow on them his blessings and mercy. Angels will encircle them, asking Allah the remission of their sins until the assembly disperse. So Ali said, Verily by the Lord of the Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. Then my father replied, By him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of mankind, whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mentions this event, there shall remain none grieved, but Allah will remove his grief. There shall remain none distressed, but Allah will dispel his distress. There shall remain none wish-seeker, but Allah will grant his wish. Ali happily said, Verily by the Lord of the Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners and the blessed, in this world and the next. Allahumma salli ala
Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjal farajahum. Jazakallah khair jazah, our dear brother Nihal, thank you so much for that wonderful recitation of Hadith Sikasa. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajjal farajahum. Very quickly, before we begin the majlis, we have a request for Surah Al-Fatiha for tonight's sponsors. If we could please recite the Surah Mubarak Al-Fatiha for the following marhumin and marhumat: Syed Ashfaq Hussain Rizvi, Kaniz Haider, Bakri Begum, Kumail Hussain, Zohair Hussain, and the family members of the sponsors and all the mu'mineen and mu'minat. Surah Mubarak Al-Fatiha. With great pleasure and great privilege, we kindly request Sheikh Nur Muhammad to please take the member. Salah ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir la'in ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. والعاقبة لأهل التقوى واليقين والجنة للموحدين والنار للمشركين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. Once again, we thank Almighty Allah for giving us the opportunity to remember our beloved master Aba Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam and to take lesson or two from his mission or heavenly initiative on earth. As we mentioned last night, my dear brothers and sisters, the aim or the purpose of this majalis, whether physical or virtual, is to be able to color ourselves with the true colors of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Last night, we looked at Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the heavenly initiative on earth. Towards the end of our discourse, we discussed some of our responsibilities towards this heavenly initiative. And we encouraged ourselves and our beloved brothers and sisters to try as much as we can to take this message, which is universal, to the people, to our neighbors, to our friends. And by so doing, we will be regarded as part and parcel of Ansar al-Husayn alayhi salam. The verse I've just quoted is again one of the verses I quoted and explained last night. It is Quran 3, verse 104. God Almighty said, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ. There must be some nations or groups amongst you, يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ, who invite to goodness and who promote righteousness and forbid evilness. All might not be able to do. Hence Allah says, some of you should rise to promote righteousness and forbid evilness. Some of you must rise to promote the establishment of social justice and peaceful coexistence. Now, departing from this beautiful verse of glorious Quran, our topic of tonight is to look at the media roles played by Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam in regards or in relation to the mission or the message of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Ahlul Bayt led the way when it comes to disseminating or promoting the message of our beloved Aba Abdullah alayhi salam. The examination of tonight will be of the following stages. Number one, we will discuss what is media and the importance of media. Number two, we will look at Husayni symbols or rituals. And then the last stage of the examination, we will focus on the media roles played and exhibited by our beloved Imam Zain al-Abidin, so that we become more inspired to do more when it comes to this beautiful universal message. As you know very well, Imam Husayn is a universal figure. We cannot contain him within the four walls of our houses alone, or within the four walls of our mosques, or Husayniyas, or Imam Baths. Husayn alayhi salam transcends time and space. In other words, his message is not for only us. It is forever human being, forever champion of freedom lover. Now let's begin with our examination. What is media and why media is important, or what is the importance of media? Media, as scholars in the field of sociology define, it is means of establishing connection between the source and then the future. What do I mean? So there's a source of information and there is target for this information. So the connection between the source of information And the target of the information is what media is all about. Hence they mentioned media has four elements. When these four elements are met, then you can be rest assured there will be media. The first element is the source of information, because media is all about news, it's all about information. The source of the news is crucial. It's one of the major elements of media. The second source or the second element of media is what? Is the target group. Now, you have this information. Who are the target group? What is the aim of this information? What is the aim of this news? Why are you trying your level best to write this news? Or to read this news? Or to expose people to this news? Who are the targets? That's the mustaqbal. And the third element of media is the wasila. How do you disseminate? So means of disseminating a news or information is also an element which is very, very important in media. Could be Facebook, could be Twitter, could be Instagram, it could be Mimbar. Mimbar is a media outlet. It could be, you know, Marcia, it could be Nova. These are all means of transmitting information. It could be television. And then the fourth element of media is what? Is the information itself. That information which you're going to share by these means, what is it all about? What is it talking about? What is the subject matter of this information? So these are the four major elements of media as per the teachings of sociologists. Now, what is the importance of media? Or why media is important? I'm mentioning this, my dear brothers and sisters, to first and foremost inspire myself and inspire you to do more when it comes to the message of Ahl al-Bayt, and most especially the message of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam and that of Imam Sahib al-Asri al-Saman. Media is very important, as you all know, and we cannot overemphasize on the importance or the impact or effect of media in society or human life. The first importance of media is what? It connects nations. You are living in the United States. I am living here in the UK. Someone living there in Africa. We all watching CNN or watching BBC or watching Ireland by TV or any media outlet or listen to a radio station talking about someone or certain culture. We are in different places, but watching the same thing, what does it do? It connects us. Not physical, virtually. And what's the connection? The connection is that we are all getting one same information at the same time. No majlis. A Maulana sitting somewhere in UK or in Pakistan or in Africa speaking, and you sitting where you are, and I'm sitting where I am, watching and listening, it is connecting us. So media number one is important because it connects nations, it connects people, it connects generations. That's number one. Number two importance of media is what? Media is a member of Thakafa, as scholars mentioned. It is a source of civilization or a source of a culture. Meaning what? People today learn from media. There are many people out there who depend on media for their information. There are many of us out there who depend on Mimbar for your Islamic information or the teachings of Ahl al-Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam. So therefore, it's a source of thakafa, civilization. It's a source of education. It's a source of information. Hence, it is very, very important. The third importance of media is what? Media is a means of recharging our inner machines or hard drives. What do I mean? You know, sometimes One becomes moody or becomes so down. Maybe because of life or situation, and then all of a sudden you watch something on media. It could be comedy, it could be some very healthy movie or a lecture or Marcia or Nora or Mankabot. The moment you hear it via media, could be TV station, could be YouTube, could be Instagram, could be Facebook, you feel good, you feel charged. So it is a means of recharging people, or a means of, you know, recharging our inner machines, refreshing us. Hence, it is important. And the third importance of media is what? As per now, the teaching of Islam is a means of propagation, it's a means of sharing good information. When it comes to the teachings of Islam, it's a way of exposing the world to the universal message of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When I use my Instagram or Twitch to send the message about Ahlul Bayt, what's happening? I'm exposing people to this beautiful message of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasallam. And so therefore, we cannot belabor the point when it comes to the importance of media, especially in this day and age. Although it was important also then, but today it's a global village, as you all know. We are able to connect within a twinkle of an eye. Something will happen just now in Africa or in UK, and within a minute, millions of people will get to know about it. So the aim of tonight's discussion, really, my dear brothers and sisters, is to encourage myself and all of us to say, you know what? We've got a powerful tool in media to disseminate the message of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam to the people of the world. Now let's come to the second stage of my examination, which is of great importance. Husseini symbols or Husseini rituals. You know, brothers and sisters, we need to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have the greatest initiative. And this greatest initiative that we have is lively, Hayawi. What is this greatest initiative? The initiative is Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Imam al-Husayn, my dear brothers and sisters, is not just an individual who was born in Medina and died in Karbala. No. Imam is the greatest initiative. And this initiative requires strong media coverage. Don't you think so? It's not something we should keep to ourselves. It's not something we should just confine it, as I mentioned last night, with the four corners of our houses, with the four corners of our mosques. But it is something that has to be disseminated wide and far. And to understand that, I bring you now and invite you to my second stage of the examination. Husseini rituals or Husseini symbols. What is a symbol as per the teachings of Islam? You may want to call it a ritual. Symbol from the Arabic word called sha'ira. Plural is sha'air. And Quran mentioned about sha'air. Quran 22 verse 32 to begin with. Said, وَمَنْ يُعَذِّمُ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. وَمَنْ يُعَذِّمُ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ. He said, whoever honor the symbols of Allah, the rituals of Allah, honoring those rituals is a sign of having piety. It's a sign of being closer to Allah. What is a symbol? Or what is a ritual? You know, there's a difference between symbol and optional act of worship, almost perhaps. Kindly, I beg you, pay attention, my dear brothers and sisters. An example of an optional act of worship is Salatul Layl, night prayers or Namaz Isha. Every optional act of worship is not symbol, but every symbol can be an optional act of worship. Symbol is what? Symbol is a means of disseminating a message. It's a means of sharing an information. So, symbol is what is used to give a message. Salatul Layl, we don't use it to give message. Or any other mustahabbat. Now, the symbols or Husseini symbols are of two types. We have established ones and we have changeable ones, non-established. What do I mean by established Husseini symbols or Husseini rituals? They are those that can be traced from the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. They are called established because there are clear texts from the teachings of Ahlul Bayt to establish them. Those that are changeable are not established. They are so simply because there are no clear or straightforward traditions or texts to prove or to establish them. Let's begin with the established ones. Kindly pay attention. You know them very well. The established Husseini symbols or rituals are number one, the majalis. Majalis is also a media outlet. It's a means of disseminating message. It's a means of creating awareness about Abdullah and his mission. Why is it established? Because we have a riwayat from Ahlul Bayt, you know it. Man jalasa majlisan from Imam al-Bakir alayhi salam. Yuhya fihi amruna. Lam yamut kalbuhu yawma taqutu al-qulub. Whoever attends a majlis where our affairs is being given life, that person's heart will not die on a day when hearts will be dead. Again, you've got another riwayat from Imam al-Bakir alayhi salam. He said to his companion, Fudayl ibn Yusuf, "Atajlisuna wa tatahaddathu?" Do you people sit and perhaps talk and discuss about us? Fudayl said, "Yes, we do gather, we do meet, we do discuss about you." Then what was the response of Imam al-Bakir alayhi salam? He said, "Inni uhibbu tilkal majalis." I am fond of those gatherings. The gatherings where we have been mentioned, where our affairs are given life. So therefore, majlis is an established Husseini symbol. It's an established Husseini ritual. No one can change it. It is a means of disseminating information, of declaring our bara'ah against oppressors and oppression. The second established symbol of Husseini is what? Is tears, crying, lamenting. When Masa'ib is being mentioned, it's an established ritual, it's an established symbol of God. And I told you, why do we say symbol of God? Because it reminds people of Allah, it reminds people of Ahlul Bayt, it reminds people of Abu Abdullah. We've got the riwayat on the rewards of shedding tears for Ahlul Bayt. One beautiful riwayah mentioned. Whoever we are mentioned to him from Imam al-Bakir alayhi salam, and then tears drops from his eyes, Allah will forgive him his sins. Another riwayah says, feeling grief and sadness on account of knowing What happened to Ahlul Bayt of Zulm? It is tasbih, it is ibadah. So these tears is a message, it's a symbol of Allah. It's Hussein's symbol, because Hussein's symbol is Allah's symbol. It's a strong ritual which was established by Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdalus salatu wa as-salam. And when you cry, you should know that it's a message. You are declaring war against oppression and oppressors. The third symbol which is established is Ma'tam. The Arabs call it Latmiya. The Ma'tam, there is no like clear-cut tradition. What we have is called Dalilun Imba'i. Silence, approval of an imam. When Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam was beheaded and brutally butchered on the 10th day of Muharram, the ladies and the children of Abu Abdullah came and sat next to the head, next to the body of Abu Abdullah. They began to cry. They began to hit on their face, on their chest. Imam Hussein al-Abdi was the imam of the time, he was there. He kept quiet. His quietness simply means approval. This is what they call Dalilun Imba'i. It was approved by Imam Hussein al-Abdi. Because if it was wrong, he was going to reprimand them. He was going to tell them not to do it. So these are the three main established Husseini symbols or Husseini rituals. And really when you discuss about rituals and symbols, Allah discusses also about Hajj, isn't it? You look at Safa and Marwa. Allah says, "Inna Safa wal Marwa min sha'air Allah." In this Safa and Marwa are amongst the symbols of Allah, rituals of Allah. Meaning what? Safa and Marwa is the means of message, and it reminds people of Allah. And what message that Safa and Marwa gives? It reminds people of yearning for Allah as a way of humility and humbleness. Slaughtering in Mina in Hajj, Allah says, "Is min sha'air Allah wal budna ja'alnaha lakum min sha'air Allah." The slaughtering in Mina, we made it for you as a symbol of Allah. It's giving message. It's not the blood. It's not the animal. Likewise, majalat, tears, latum matam, nova marcia. These are established Husseini symbols from Ahlul Bayt alayhim afdal salati wa askar salam. There are no doubt other ways of remembering Abu Abdullah, other rituals, other symbols that we do not have riwayat from Ahlul Bayt. One of them, as I mentioned, is using media. One of them, for instance, you go out, give food to people in the name of Abu Abdullah and the rest. How do we go about them? Our scholars beautifully mentioned, my dear brothers and sisters, that any symbol is accepted so long as it is within three particular requirements. The first requirement is that it is a demonstration of sorrowness or grief on account of what happened to Abu Abdullah Hussein Ali. As narration mentioned, كُلُّ الْبُكَاءُ وَالْجَزَعُ مَقْرُوبُ مَا خَلَى الْبُكَاءُ وَالْجَزَعُ لِلْحُسَيْنِ. Every tears and grief is makruh, except the one for Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Someone will come forward and say, "But why you want to cry? Why you want to grieve? You want to get frustrated?" Someone will say, "No, it's against akal." I said, "No. Allah provided us with akal and the heart. What is the work of the akal is to analyze and process. What is the work of the heart is to grieve, is to be happy. So we are sad for what happened to Abu Abdullah. So long as it is to show sadness and to grieve, there's no problem." And Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam, he cried over the shahada of Abu Fadl Abbas. He cried over the shahada of Ali al-Akbar. Sayyidina Zainab shed tears. Imam Zainab Abdin shed tears. And so the first condition of non-established Husseini symbols or rituals is that it should be to show grief and to show that one is sad for what happened to Abu Abdullah and his beloved household and companion. Second condition for non-established Husseini rituals or symbols. It's not. It should not be something that will bring the school of thought into disrepute. That will destroy the image of the school of thought. That will make Shias laughing stock. That will make people to disrespect the school of thought. It's an individual judgment. You know, if I do this, it will put the school of thought into disrepute. Why do you want to do it? Scholars said, do any rituals in the name of Abba Abdullah, so long as it will not bring the name of the school or the madhab of Ahl al-Bayt into disrepute. And the third, last but not least condition, scholars mentioned, for non-established rituals is what? Is that do the rituals so long as there will be no physical harm or no medical harm to you. And this is a point that I would really like to advise myself and advise my brothers and sisters, wherever you are. This is Arba'in, or even beyond Arba'in. Every program that you have, if the Lord does not allow you to convene at the world, don't do it. And if you do it at the house, ensure the advices and the measures given to you by the medical expert are followed. Don't say, no, I'm going to do it in the name of Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein will protect you. Rasulullah will protect me. No social distancing, no face mask. It doesn't work out that way. So scholars said one condition of non-established rituals or Husseini symbols is that there shouldn't be any medical harm to a person. Now, after all this, there are other non-established symbols or rituals of Husseini that really are important for us as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. All in the spirit of taking Husayn to the next level. In other words, taking his message to the next level. Number one is Qanatul Husayn, having channels in the name of Abba Abdullah. Alhamdulillah, now we have so many TV stations. You know, you support it. By supporting it, you are promoting the message of Abba Abdullah Hussein, salawatullahi wa sallamu alayhi. And as I mentioned last night, even using your own social media platforms, do something to promote this message. Youth within our communities, ladies and gentlemen, do something. Represent Ali ibn Akbar. Represent Bibi Sakina. Represent Imam al-Hussein. Do something. You are creative, I know, our youth. Don't wait to be told to do something. In the name of Imam Hussein, in the name of promoting social justice. So we need these channels all over to promote the message of Imam Hussein Ali. Number two, we need Masrah Hussein. A play, sort of something to be like in a theater, if you like. A play, nice, professionally done play. By the members of our communities. Show Karbala in a professional way, in a decent way, for people to appreciate. Because there are certainly, if you do them in a play, you know, it resonates with people. Why can't we do that? Alhamdulillah, we have Husseini saying today, more than 80 countries of the world. May Allah bless those who started it. But we can take this to the next level, isn't it? We need play. I know our communities do sometimes within the confinement of our madrasa, but we need something proper. We get professionals to help us. And then, of course, the other non-established that scholars advise and suggested is that we work for the Husayn, endowment in the name of Abba Abdullah. We have people who are well to do, establish and offer it somewhere where it is needed in the name of Imam Husayn. Imam Husayn offer. Establish a clinic somewhere, if you can afford, Imam Hussein clinic. Oh no, people are building a clinic or building a well in the name of Abba Abdullah Hussein. You are a student, you go on campus. You want to write your thesis. You want to write your dissertation. If really it's something that you can do, why not take Karbala and write dissertation on Karbala? By so doing, You will be exposing the world to the beautiful message of Abba Abdullah. And you will be playing your part, my dear brothers and sisters. Now, this brings me to the media roles played by Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam when it comes to disseminating the message of Imam Hussein. Ahlul Bayt showed us the way. They will not tell us to do before they implemented it themselves. And I'm mentioning this, my brothers and sisters, to inspire myself and to inspire you to say, you know what, we've been having this method for quite a long time and we've done something, but we need to take it to the next level. The first role that Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam played was what scholars call ad-dawr jama'i, public role, where he came out publicly and addressed people. Example, Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam in Sham openly spoke, looked at their enemies, and he began to address them. And you know what he said, Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. He said, "Oh people, who knows me. And who does not know me, let me introduce myself to you. I am Ali, the son of Hussein, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib." Then he mentioned, son of the Prophet, son of Khalid, the son of Zamzam, the son of Makkah, the son of Safa and Marwa, the son of the one who went out giving people's accounts. This is Uslubul Jama'i. It's a public media outlet where he came out publicly. And you remember very well, he mentioned publicly again in Sham that we, the Ahlul Bayt, are given 6 things by Allah and elevated with 7 things. He said, number one, we are given knowledge. And number two, we are given patience. Openly was mentioned. He said, number three, we are given eloquence. And number four, we are given honor by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number five, he said, we are given bravery. Allah made us brave. And number six, he said, our love is placed in the heart of people. And then of course he said, we are promoted and elevated by Allah through 7 things or 7 personalities. He mentioned number one, Mukhtar is from us. Number two, Hamza is from us, or people if you do not know. Number three, he said, Ali ibn Abi Talib is from us. Number four, he said, Ja'far al-Tayyar is from us. Number five, he said, Imam al-Hassan is from us. Number six, Imam al-Husayn is from us. And number seven, Siddiq al-Tahira is from us. This was what is called Jama'in. You go out publicly, like the way we do sometimes, through who is Husayn and other organizations. Husayni Day programs, excellent programs, or people go out and then distribute food to those who are in need. Some distribute flowers. This was noble Jama'in. It's a media outlet. We need to continue exploring in disseminating the message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The second media role played by Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam is what? It was dialogue. Imam adopted a dialogue with the aim of promoting the message of Imam Hussein and creating awareness and reminding people of what Abba Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam stood for. Typical example you know very well. In Sham, in the court of Yazid, when Azan was being recited, when the Mu'adhan reached Ashhadu Anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Imam Zain al-Abidin looked at Yazid and asked him, is this your grandfather or my grandfather? If you tell me it's your grandfather, you are a liar. And if you tell me it's my grandfather, why then attacked us? So therefore, Imam Zain al-Abidin adopted a dialogue as a strategy, as a media outlet to disseminate and promote the message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And a typical example of the dialogue of Imam Zain al-Abidin is what? So the old man who approached him and said to him, We thank Allah for making us triumphant and victorious over you. Imam Zainuddin looked at this old man and said to him, have you read the following verse of the glorious Quran? وَآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَ حَقَّهُ That give the near of kings their rights. He said, yes, I've read. He said, we are the Qurba. Then he asked the old man, have you read? إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذِبَ عَنْكُمْ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيْتَحْرَكُمْ تَطْحِيرًا. The old man said, yes, I read this ayah. And then the last one, the Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam said, old man, have you read the ayah of glorious Quran? قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةُ فِي الْقُرْبَى. He said, yes, he said, we are the Qurba. We are the Ahl al-Bayt of the Holy Prophet. That old man changed his mind and loved Ahl al-Bayt and loved Imam Zain al-Abidin. Because initially they were told, these are rebels. We're fighting Yazid. Then he realized, no, these are not rebels. These are the children of Al-Bayt al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this dialogue. When you go to school, when you go to universities, dialogue with people. Your aim is not to make them Shia. Your aim is not to make them Muslims. Guidance is in the hand of Allah. But your aim is to create awareness. Is to share this beautiful message. To change perceptions about Islam. Alhamdulillah, as I said, people are doing very well, but we need to do more. Today we have a lot of podcasts that are going on. Our youth are trying their level best, but let's do more. And the last media role played by Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam was emotional way of promoting the message of Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam. Why emotional? Imam Zain al-Abidin, when they returned back to the holy city of Medina, he adopted different emotional ways of promoting this universal message or heavenly initiative on earth. For example, he would come across a butcher and he would ask a butcher, oh man, when you slaughter these animals, do you give them water? He said, of course, it is sunnah to give water. Then he would say to the man, my father was dying water. This is emotional way of promoting a message. For example, he would come across a funeral undertaker and would look at the man and ask him, oh man, when I die, will you bury me or not? So of course, everyone deserves to be buried. So my father's body was mutilated, was left for 3 days without burial. Likewise, he heard a man calling in Medina, stranger, stranger, stranger. He walked toward this man and inquired, are you a stranger because you do not have a place to stay? Are you a stranger because you do not have what to eat? Are you a stranger because you do not have what to wear? Are you a stranger because you don't know where to go? If yes, I am here to help you. The man said, no, I've got all this, and then you are not a stranger. A stranger is Garibu Karbala. A stranger is my beloved father, Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam. This is what? It's emotional way of promoting the message of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. So therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, we as lovers and followers of Ahl al-Bayt have responsibilities, as I mentioned last night. Me mentioning this doesn't mean that we've done nothing and we are doing nothing. There are a lot of progress within our communities, but we need to do more to take this message to the next level. It is of great importance that we should try that one day, even the day of Ashura is listed in the calendar of the United Nations, so that people get to know. We need to start somewhere. We need to think about it. And you know very well, Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam are fond of anyone who's tried in his or her own small way to spread the message. And lastly, I would like to take this opportunity to invite one and all, and especially the youth of our communities. You are, alhamdulillah, blessed. You've got the knowledge. You've got the know-how. Use it one or the other to spread the message of Imam al-Hussein. It's a message of social justice. And the world is in need of this message. Let us use it and spread this message. And by so doing, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will bless us and will make things easy for us. And the Imam of our time will intervene on our behalf. We take our heart once again to the holy land of Karbala. And remember a few lines of the Masa'ib of Ahlul Bayt al-Isma wa Tahara. As you know very well, it is said, كل عين باقية يوم القيامة إلا عينا بقت للحسين. Every eye will shed tears on the day of Qiyamah except the eye that shed tears sincerely for Abu Abdullah. You know, narration mentioned, my dear brothers and sisters, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam was brutally butchered an hour before sunset or an hour before Maghrib. And we are told in the narration that Imam al-Hussein came and bidded farewell. As he was bidding the farewell, he did not see his daughter Sakina. He asked Zainab, where is my Sakina? He said, Sakina is there. Aba Abdullah walked towards Sakina. He hugged her. Sakina said, Father, take us back to Medina. He said, Alayka bis sabr, ya Sakina, be patient, oh Sakina. Abu Abdullah bidded farewell and began to head towards the battlefield, isn't it? Sakina called out, Father, come. It's like telling Father one last hunger. When have you known me to sleep without being on your lap, my father? Narration mentioned as Abu Abdullah al-Hussein was hugging his beloved daughter, the enemies came and began to attack Abu Abdullah. Abu Abdullah then head towards the battlefield. He began to defend. He defended and defended. All of a sudden, an arrow came on the chest of Abu Abdullah. While Abu Abdullah was trying to remove the arrow from his chest, another arrow came on the shoulder of Abu Abdullah. Narration mentioned, while he was trying to remove the arrow from his shoulder, another arrow came on this other shoulder. Allahu Akbar. While Abu Abdullah was trying to remove the arrow from here, arrow came on his back. They showered him with arrows. All of a sudden, Abu Abdullah al-Hussein fell on his back on the ground. While Hussein was on the ground, the enemy did not know whether he was alive or dead. But they knew Abu Abdullah had a special relationship with Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam. They decided to call out, let us go and attack Zainab. They did that just to know if Abu Abdullah was alive or dead. When they called out Zainab, he heard the name Zainab. Narration mentioned, Imam al-Hussein tried to rise up, but he fell on his back on an arrow. Ajrukum ala Allah, my dear brothers and sisters. They then came and surrounded the body of Abu Abdullah. Someone kicked the head of Abu Abdullah. The other one kicked the chest of Abu Abdullah. The other one kicked the leg of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. They did not know who to finish off Abu Abdullah. Al-La'in ibn al-La'in al-Shimr came. He said, name him with me. He came, we are told. When he came, he began to disrespect Abu Abdullah. He poked the lips of Abu Abdullah. Some narration said he pulled the beard of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. That is why it is said when Amir al-Mu'mineen was in the darkness of the night going to bury Bibi Fatima alayhi salam, Imam al-Hassan came and sat next to the body of his beloved mother. He hugged her, he called out, Amma, Amma, Amma. There was painful quietness. Then Abu Abdullah came next to the body of Fatima. We are told when he came next to the body of Fatima, he hugged his beloved mother. He called her Amma, Amma. Amir al-Mu'mineen was inspired. Ya Ali, go and remove Hussein from the chest of Fatima al-Zahra. You know, here scholars mention, Arbab al-Makatil mentioned, if the angels did not bear to see Hussein on the chest of Fatima, how did the angels bear to see Shimr on the chest of Abu Abdullah? Shimr sat on the chest of Abu Abdullah. He began to pop the lips of Abu Abdullah, and he began to pull the beard of Abu Abdullah. You know what Shimr did? Imam Rida alayhi salam mentioned. They did not kill Hussein, they slaughtered Hussein. You know, there's a difference between killing and slaughtering. When a person is killed, he dies instantly. But when a person is slaughtered, it takes time for the soul to go away. Shimr began to stab on the neck of Abu Abdullah Hussein, until he beheaded Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam. You know what narration mentioned? When they beheaded Abu Abdullah, they began to loot the belongings of Abu Abdullah. This one removed the turban. This one removed the shoe. The last one who came, he saw the ring on the right finger of Abu Abdullah. Narration mentioned this ring was the ring of Rasulullah. He tried to remove the ring. He couldn't. He got a knife. He cut off the finger of Abu Abdullah. ألا لعنة الله على الكون الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منكلب ينكلبون إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. Brothers and sisters, raise up your hands wherever you may be. Let's make dua. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to instill the true love of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad in our hearts. May Allah make us true as Adaran Hussein alayhi salam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to deprive us of the true love of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Allah in and out, grant us with the tawfiqat to attend the majalis, whether virtually or physically, to remember the martyrs of Karbala al-Muqaddas. Allah, we pray to you that our brothers and sisters, wherever they may be, who are not well, either out of corona or any sickness, may Allah cure them, it is cured. Those who are well, may Allah continue to shower us with the blessings of health, inshallah. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, marhumin, may Allah forgive them and grant them Jannah al-Firdaws. Our sons and daughters, may Allah protect them wherever they may be. We ask Allah to expedite the appearance of the Imam of our time. Wherever we are, may Allah seat us in peace and tranquility. May Allah seat us in peace and tranquility. May Allah seat us in peace and tranquility. And may Allah protect us with His protection. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill our legitimate desires. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وعلى طيبين الطاهرين مع تمام الحسين.
Rani Muhammad, Jazakallah Khair, Jazakallah Sheikh for that incredible majlis. We now kindly request Brother Abbas Zaidi for a noha. Hussein.
Hi Sajjad. Hai Sajjad, Taha Ziyan hai Shimr ke aur Natawa Sajjad hai. Taha Ziyan hai Shimr ke aur Natawa Sajjad hai. Phir bhi lekar chal raha Sankarwa Sajjad hai. Taha Ziyan hai Shimr ke aur Natawa Sajjad hai. Deen ka har ilm hai dar, azmat hai aale rasool. Deen ka har ilm hai dar, azmat hai aale rasool. Aur Quran khuda ka paas ba Sajjad hai. Taha Ziyan hai Shimr ke aur Natawa Sajjad hai. Is qadar rona lahu ka karta hai zahir yahi. اس قدر رونا لہو کا کرتا ہے ظاہر یہی آل احمد کے مصاحب کا پورا سجاد ہے تازیان شمر کے اور ناتواں سجاد ہے جس طرح ہے اس زمین پہ آسمان سایہ پیغن جس طرح ہے اس زمین پہ آسمان سایہ پیغن اس طرح ہی تھی کہ سر پہ سائبہ سجاد ہے تازیان شمر کے اور ناتواں سجاد ہے تازیان شمر کے اور ناتواں سجاد ہے پاس رکھ کر کچھ کہانا قاتل اکبر کو بھی پاس رکھ کر کچھ کہانا قاتل اکبر کو بھی دیکھو کتنا ہی رحم دل مہرباں سجاد ہے تازیان شمر کے اور ناتواں سجاد ہے پھر بھی لے کر چل رہا پھر بھی لے کر چل رہا سنکارواں سجاد ہے تازیان شمر کے اور ناتواں سجاد ہے
سند Hussein, Hussein, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Thank you so much, Brother Abbas, for the lovely noha. At this time, we kindly request the Brother Nihal Naqvi for ziyarah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Assalamu alayka ya Ali Amir al-Mu'mineen. Assalamu alayka ya Fatima al-Zahra. السلام عليك يا خديجة الكبرى السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله الحسين السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين خصوصا سيدي مولى أبو الفضل العباس ابن أمير المؤمنين وأختك زينب وأم كلثوم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا علي زين العابدين ومحمد ابن علي الفاقر وجعفر ابن محمد الصادق موسى بن جعفر القادم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي التقي الجواد وعلي بن محمد النقي الحادي والحسن بن علي العسكري والحجة بن الحسن المهدي أجل الله تعالى فرجك واستحل الله مخرجك وظهورك السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته
اللهم صل على
محمد وعلى محمد فجر فرجه
أحسن جزاك الله خير جزاء and dear brother Nihal for that wonderful recitation of ziyarah. This concludes our English program for tonight. Please join us back here at 9 o'clock for the Urdu Majlis, which will be recited by Maulana Uruj al-Hasan Misim Saab. So please join us back at 9 o'clock. And for tomorrow, please join us at 7:30 for the English program with Maulana Sheikh Nuru. Please join us back for English tomorrow at 7:30. Thank you so much. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.